Okay, so, well, very glad to be invited by the SUT and SUT Plus, thank you. So, well, yes, as you said, my name is David. I work in academia, I work in research. I'm an engineering by background, but my research area is actually thermophysical properties and phase behavior of complex fluid mixtures, and also metrology. But I have applied that during the last 12 years into carbon capture and storage, and now in energy transition, more hydrogen and biofuels. And it's true, you're right. I started in Spain my career, then I went to United States, then I spent 11 years in United Kingdom, first at Imperial College, and then I was very happy working with all my friends and colleagues in the University of Aberdeen for 8 years. And then for some kind of strange miracle, just before the outbreak, I was called by the Spanish government to go back to Spain and actually to move forward the agenda of energy transition and researching carbon capture and storage, but now here back in Spain. So that's all about me. And this is the title of the presentation. It's about our carbon budget is running out, our excuses too. And let's go to the business. So, well, maybe first I would like to give you a very brief, let's say, outlook of what we're going to see. First, I'm going to state or to establish the basic, the fundamentals about climate change, very basic, just to be all in the same pace and same page. And then I will go for some of the climate mitigation strategies we might find out there. Then I will move to the carbon capture and storage. I will not focus much in the utilization part, but I will always welcome questions at the end, the questions and answers session. And I will end my presentation with some kind of blockers and drivers for carbon capture and storage, because even when now there is a kind of a boom again, some kind of traction, it has been there for some years, and we have experienced those that we are interested on this subject, have experienced some kind of drawbacks back and forth. So I would like to just summarize those blockers and drivers that I see they are playing together regarding carbon capture and storage. So anyway, first, so we already have all the facts about climate change and they are there. So this is a slide where I try to present the correlation between the increment in temperature on the top left and the global elevated sea level change in the bottom left, so the B figure. Then the global average greenhouse gas concentrations in the top right, the C figure. And finally, the global anthropogenic CO2 emissions, they're also accumulated in the bottom right. And all of them versus in the x-axis, the time in years. More or less starting with the pre-industrial revolution, not in United Kingdom definitely, but yes, let's say in continental Europe and elsewhere. And then you can clearly see a correlation between when we started shooting the global anthropogenic CO2 emissions that, as you can see in the top right, you can see the emissions of greenhouse gases that basically are the carbon dioxide, and then the methane, CH4, and also the nitrous oxide, so the laughing gas, N2O. And then you can see how there is a rapid increase from the Industrial Revolution, and especially immediately after the Second World War, when we are starting producing electricity in power plants with coal-fired power plants, and also have a massive increment of the demand of oil for transportation also. And it can clearly correlate very well with the rapid increment in the temperature, average temperature worldwide, and also with an increment in the average sea level. And what is very important to look at is the figure on the bottom right, so the global anthropogenic CO2 emissions, where you can see this very massive increment in CO2 emissions per year in gigatons, so giga is 10 to 9, remember? So and we are now under, well, this is actually up to 2010, but you can see how it's not only important the amount of emissions per year, also is extremely important the accumulative CO2 emissions, because CO2 is a very stable volume molecule, the carbon dioxide, so it stays stable in the atmosphere for a long time, trapping the heat, causing this greenhouse effect. And that's why it's not only about shooting down emissions, it's also about taking into account we have already emitted before. In terms of global warming, we know that methane and nitrous oxide, these other two greenhouse gases, and also the halocarbons, are much has a much bigger global impact than carbon dioxide. But it's also true that they are less stable, so it stays in the atmosphere for is lower for a shorter time. But also we have to also take into account, especially the negative feedback we have of methane now from permafrosts. So anyway, you might say, well, you talked, David, about anthropogenic, but there are also some other climate natural variation that they are caused by, not by humans. And this is true, and we mainly have the solar radiation, so solar cycle, sunspots, atmospheric greenhouse gases forcing an attenuation. We also have geological activity, like for example, volcanoes that produce aerosols that tends to cool down actually the temperature. We also have, for example, the effect of ice, or also the atmospheric dust, or the reflection of the radiation, sun radiation, what is called the albedo effect. But how do they play together? We just try to understand their behavior compared with the anthropogenic emissions. Well, I think this is on a slide that kind of summarizes very well what we are trying to say here, that actually the main factor is coming, the main reason why we have a very bad impact on the climate is due to the anthropogenic emissions. Look, we are trying to see what is the temperature anomaly in the y-axis in both figures, left and right. What you see in black is actually the observations in temperature, and what you see in red is what is we are obtaining from the different models. But on the left side, you see when we are putting together both the natural forcings, so the radiative forcings, natural causing for or the heating forces, the natural ones, and then the anthropogenic ones. Whereas in the right one, we only consider the natural forcing. For example, let me give you an example of natural forces, these vertical lines correspond to volcano eruptions. For example, Indonesia in the Agung, or in 1982, El Chinchon, for example, here in Mexico, or Pinatubo in Philippine Islands, and in 1991, and you can see that actually produce a cool down. Yes, it's true, you can see how temperatures went down during these eruptions, even when it lasted for a very short period of time, it's maximum 1, even 2 years, normally less. But anyway, the important message here is that in the right side, if you don't consider anthropogenic effects, the trend should be the blue one, but actually the one you observe is the black one. Only when you put together the anthropogenic emissions is when you see a perfect match between the observations and the models. So we can actually summarize that in the what is called the forcing, radiative forcing, in watts per square meter in the y-axis. In red line, in red, the red arrow means warming, we're warming the earth, whereas the blue one is cooling, we are cooling the earth. So as you can see, there is a heat trapping emission due to greenhouse gases, okay, in red, that goes up to 3 watts per square meter. But we also have a combination of different other effects like sun, that is very small, or land use, for example, changes, or aerosols used by caused by urban pollution that is actually cooling, or those aerosols from volcanic venting, as I said. And at the end, what you have actually, if you add up all of them, is a warming effect of around, not 3, but around 2.3 watts per square meter. And from this 2.3, around 1.7, 1.8, is just corresponding actually to the anthropogenic greenhouse gases, and a big bunch of that is coming from carbon dioxide emissions. And we can see the impact, the observed changes on the planet. So this is already happening. So on the top left, we just see the temperature increment of almost 1 degree already, 0.85 Celsius in this century. So on the top right, you can see the sea increment levels that is almost 20 centimeters, and with an increasing acidity in concentration of protons of 26%, this means in pH scale is a reduction of 0.1, remember it's a logarithm scale. On the bottom left, you see the ice loss both in Greenland and the Antarctic, and you see that the only one in 10 years from 1992 to 2001, and the next decade from 2000 to 2000, 11, we multiply by a factor of 5 the ice loss in gigatons per year. And also another critical effect is how we are having more severe extreme weather conditions. Because if you see these plots, it's not only that we are actually increasing, moving to the right, the media, the average of extreme weather scenarios, also we are increasing the variance. So we are spreading the curve. So that's why we have more actually likelihood of being of these very extreme weather effects. And on the top, you can see actually a very visual impact in the coral reef in Australia, how we had that before and how we have it after. So yes, our house is on fire because these are projections of temperature models for the future from now to 2100, so by the end of the century. And you see on the red models, what they say is if we keep on business as usual, we will increment temperature from now, not from previous industrial revolution, from now, and around 4, even up to 6 Celsius, so it will be a terrible disaster. If we do all the possible, all in our hands to actually keep to curtail these carbon dioxide emissions and greenhouse gas emissions, we'll maintain this temperature around this barrier you have heard about of 1.5 Celsius increment, okay? So what about, where are these greenhouse gas emissions coming? Looking at the economic sector, we could look at the primary sector, but I'm looking at just economic centers. And let's say that the main chunk comes from electricity and heat production. As you see there, 25%, mainly only goes to buildings, for example, heating buildings and not the industry. This is basically electricity and heat production. Then you also have AFOLU, this is the land forest, so it's forestry and land use, is around 20%, 24%. Transport, 15%, industry, 21%, right? And the total in gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent emissions in 2010 was 49, so almost 50 gigatons. So we are already transitioning to a lower carbon fuel mix. Yes, it's already happening. It's still, but it should carry on, move forward and more steeply and more quicker. These are just real numbers and projections up to 2040 from BP Energy Outlook. And you can see how we have a decrease, obviously, in the oil, the shares of primary energy, for example, in the oil, the coal. We have a first, if we look at, for example, the right figure, we see how the coal dropped, the use of coal dropped when we started increasing the use of oil, first in 1950s, 60s, after the Second World War. And now, again, we have a second drop of coal. We are increasing the amount of renewables for electricity production. And the same, we are seeing how the trend of oil is going down, the same with coal, gas is going up, and then non-fossil energies are going up. Anyway, so we have seen what is climate change, the reasons, the drivers. We see what is the picture in terms of energy and energy demand. And let's talk about what can we do with that. So we have options. One is what is called climate change mitigation policies, and the other one is adaptation. In 10 years ago, nobody was actually thinking much about adaptation. Well, yes, the IPCC, yes, but we were all about mitigation. Now we are at a reality where we also have to think about adaptation. Differences, remember, adaptation means this is already happening. We have to start investing money, for example, in sea barriers, in moving, displacing population out of the sea coast and all these type of things. And more stringent measures. Whereas mitigation basically means reducing the greenhouse gas emissions. This is what it is. How can we do this reducing greenhouse gas emissions? Well, there are different options. First of all, and all of them should play together. So because there is not a magic silver bullet that could actually solve all the problems and troubles. But basically, we should actually increase the use of renewable energy sources, and thanks God, it's already happening. You know, the price of onshore wind, for example, is dropping, and the same with the solar. So this is happening already, and we should carry on that. Use of alternative fuels, for example, switching fuels. You know that the carbon intensity, I mean, the amount of carbon dioxide you emit for megajoule of energy you produce, or for example, natural gas compared with coal, is almost half. So you are halving almost the amount of CO2 you produce for the same energy unit. So we are going to have to switch fuels, but it's not enough. We also have to go to move to clean fuels, for example, and energy vectors, like, for example, hydrogen. Hydrogen You burn it or you use it in a fuel cell and you basically produce water and energy. So it's fine. Energy savings, I can give you a lot of examples. For example, let's think about your incandescent light bulbs, the old ones, the Newton ones. Per every 100 units of coal used in a power plant to produce electricity, you will end up having only two energy units for light. So you are losing 98. So this is not efficient and we should improve. Also increasing the efficiency in the supply chains. For example, I always give the same example. Don't you find it strange, if not weird, if not crazy actually, to eat, let's say, bananas produced in New Zealand, let's say. So we have a huge, massive supply chain transport by ships that are actually producing a lot of greenhouse emissions. Reduce waste generation. This actually entails to circular economy. It makes sense because if you reuse more and you decrease the amount of waste you generate, then you are again reducing the amount of greenhouse gas emissions. So the greenhouse emissions. Well, we have to start thinking about our own responsibilities, not only about what policies, governments, industry could do. It's also about ourselves, the final users. So we also have to watch out on what we're doing with our carbon footprint. We know that if we use a big car, an SUV, for example, we have to be realistic. To move only one person rather than four, we are multiplying by four the number of greenhouse gas emissions you might produce if you are going in one small car, three people, let's say. So I can give you lots of examples, or reduce the red meat, for example. I hope that somebody of you will ask me this type of questions at the end. But anyway. Increase of use of nuclear power. Yeah, this is controversial, but nuclear power is true. So it's in terms of carbon intensity, is fantastic. It's nothing. So what is great, almost nothing, obviously, if you look at the whole life cycle. And finally, what I want to talk to you about is carbon capture, utilization, and storage, CCUS. So what is this about? What is carbon capture and storage? I will mention something about utilization. So basically, is you go to a large source of carbon dioxide. It could be a power plant like this one, the number two. Could be also, for example, a biomass-fired power plant, or could be, for example, an industry. Let's say refinery, or could be, for example, hydrogen production by steam reforming, whatever you have there that is producing carbon dioxide. And the idea is that you also have a plant, some sort of process where you capture the CO2. So you avoid the CO2 to go into the atmosphere. Once you capture it, you compress it, and then you transport it by either pipelines or ships, and you end up storing this carbon dioxide in the place where you have enough storage capacity. And the only place, considering the huge scale of carbon dioxide emissions we are talking about, is deep underground. This is carbon capture and storage. Where could it be? Could be in saline aquifers, could be in depleted oil and gas fields, or could be also in unmineral coal seams, right? So this is basically all about carbon capture and storage. But what is said like is look easy, is not so easy, and let me explain you why. Let's first justify why the most expensive part in terms of energy efficiency and also cost, that is the carbon capture part, why is needed? Because you might be thinking, well, at the end I have some gases, flue gases coming from this source, let's say power plant, why don't I just pipe all these gases together and inject that deep underground? Well, the reason is just basically based on thermodynamics. When you are burning, you are using oxygen, but using also nitrogen. So basically what you are producing, your flue stream composition is a lot of 10%, let's say in a coal, 11% of a coal fire, is if a gas fire is more dilute, you don't have so much carbon dioxide, you have some water obviously, and you have also some excess oxygen. But the problem is that you have a huge amount of nitrogen. And you might say, well, what is the problem? Well, the problem that is not nitrogen is not compressible. So it's really a gas. So the triple point of nitrogen is a very low temperature. What it means that is that if you try to increase a lot of pressure to increase the density by increasing pressure, for example, or going down in temperature, you basically at ambient temperature, you might end up having just an increasing density of, let's say, from 20 to 100, if you go to 120 bars. So basically you are not reducing a lot of the volume of nitrogen. Whereas carbon dioxide, yes, because the critical point of carbon dioxide make it very practical, you can actually, it's doable to compress carbon dioxide into either liquid phase or supercritical phase, multiplying the density by a factor from, let's say, from again, from 30, 40 up to 800, 900 kilograms per cubic meter. So basically, in a nutshell, you can actually reduce for the same mass a lot of the volume of carbon dioxide, whereas you cannot do it with nitrogen. And if you try to store the nitrogen together with the carbon dioxide in these deep underground, let's say, storage places, you will never have enough capacity. So you have to remove, you have to separate the nitrogen from the carbon dioxide. And this is what we are trying to do with carbon capture, to reduce, to end up with a quite of pure carbon dioxide stream to be compressed and piped and storage, right? Okay, let's go to this carbon capture technologies. Basically, what is the idea? I would like you to remind you that the idea is that you can burn either already, you can use your fuel, your fossil fuel, and you can burn it using air, or you can burn it using oxygen, and then you might produce carbon dioxide with nitrogen or just carbon dioxide, or you can prepare the fuel before you obtain the energy, before you do some sort of combustion of any other reaction. And what you can see here, so the options are either you do a post-combustion. What it means is that you basically, you burn as usual in your power plants, but you retrofit or power plants on industry sources, eh? That doesn't have to be power plants. But what you have to do is, again, you are producing CO2 and nitrogen. Here comes a CO2 separation process. Basically, you have to separate these gases, and then you can release nitrogen or excess oxygen. That's not a problem. These are not harmful. But then you have this CO2, and it can be piped, compressed and piped, and then dehydrated, obviously, and then you can go deep underground. Whereas in oxyfuel, you see the blue one, what you do is, again, you burn, but you don't burn with air. You burn with oxygen. You have removed already the nitrogen before in an ASU unit, okay, a separation unit. So basically, you have to remove the nitrogen, and then if you just burn C plus O2, you will obtain just carbon dioxide. What is the problem of this process? The problem is that obviously this air separation is actually also quite energy consuming, actually, so cost also has a big cost and a penalty. The other option would be pre-combustion. What it means? It means that let's prepare the fuel. Let's not just go for burning carbon. Let's burn or use hydrogen, because hydrogen plus oxygen will give you just water and energy, right? So actually, this scheme that works with the power plant also might work for example, the production of what is called blue hydrogen. Let's see, you have natural gas here, follow my arrow, and you go what this process is called steam reforming and water gas shift, whereby you will produce a hydrogen and carbon dioxide. So you need again to separate this hydrogen and carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide can be compressed and pipe and go to the storage site. And the hydrogen can be used in either fuel cells or can be used in a special burners or in catalytic combustion or whatever source or form or use of hydrogen. And then here we are. We are already producing oxygen, nitrogen, and you don't have the carbon dioxide. Okay, finally, you can use all these type of processes in the industry. You can have refineries, smelters, you can use chemical plants, and whatever, cements. For cements, normally we use calcium looping, for example, so it was a good idea. So anyway, the main problem for carbon capture is just carbon dioxide separation. So it's something that we have been doing for many years in the past, and this is very basic for chemical engineers, but it's extremely, extremely important. So at the end, if we look at the main methods for CO2 separation, we can use a combination of temperature and pressure. We can go to a cryogenic distillation, okay? And actually we do a physical separation of the carbon dioxide. We could do what is called an absorption. Basically it's using a solvent by volume that will be able to trap this carbon dioxide and not trap without trapping the other gases. It could be done by a chemical reaction, what is called a chemical absorption, or could be by the physical forces, for example, van der Waals, okay? Or we could do what is called an ad with D, absorption. This is not about volume and solvent. This is a solvent in a surface. So we are trying to trap these carbon dioxide molecules in the surface on a solvent. Normally it's going to be a porous material because you increase a lot of the surface. And again, it could be a process where there is a chemical reaction involved, would be a chemisorption, or it could be just a physical, again, van der Waals forces, for example, like physisol. We could also use membranes that I will explain just in a nutshell what is a membrane, or we could use chemical looping or gas looping. For the sake of time, I will not go further to explain that, although it's a quite important and very, very, very helpful technology too. So basically, both, either absorption or adsorption, require this. What you see in the figure in type A, separation with other either sorbents or solvents, solvents for adsorption, solvents for absorption. So basically, you have your gas stream with CO2, you capture using these sorbent solvents, and again, you are going to have a combination of these sorbents plus CO2 that has to be regenerated. And here comes the energy penalty. Here comes the reason why energy capture, so carbon capture, is expensive in a way, energy efficient, expensive, but not so much, depending on how clever we are in the technologies, okay? But that's, this is, here comes the, our efficiency penalty and our cost penalty, because we have to regenerate the sorbent and go back and reuse it. So that's, and it plays to get, it plays in the same way, likewise for both absorption and adsorption. Membranes, no, membranes is a technology whereby you are passing the gas, there is a permeate and retentate, and basically due to the combination of three different force effects, with one of the gases, there is a selectivity, and then the, one of the gases might be the carbon dioxide or other, actually is permeating or retentating, and then you can separate. And then the cryogenic, as I said, is just a distillation column using a pressure and temperature, okay? They all of them have some benefits, some penalties, some drawbacks too. So what about, in a nutshell, the most widely used? This is what it's called the most widely used, because it has been used since the 1930s in the oil and gas industry, for example, for sweetening gases, for example, for hydrogen sulfide removal, or for actually also removal of carbon dioxide from your natural gas, is what is called the bottoms process. It's a, using a chemical AB with B sorption process, using amine, aqueous amine solutions. Basically, you have a power plant and you have two towers. You have one absorption, what is called a SUT scrubbing column, where you have your solvent, it's an amine aqueous solution. The kind of the benchmark one is 30% in weight of monoethanol amine, MEA, it's a chemical that reacts with the carbon dioxide. And then this rich solvent goes to the solvent regeneration column where you use heat, for example, to actually break again this chemical bond between the CO2 and the amine. And then you go back, you stream back the CO2 lean solvent back, right? And that's why you have kind of tell your compressed CO2 to storage, okay? And here comes the energy. This is like the most, the TRL level higher, the TRL level 9, let's say, okay, 7 to 9. So there are full chain commercial carbon capture stage projects already. So it's not just a crazy idea for some kind of researchers and academics in and at pilot scale. No, no, there are already not enough, but let's say there are already two big commercial state of the art full chain carbon capture storage plants. One is, for example, in Canada. Is what is called the Boundary Dam CCS project. Basically, it's one of the four units of a power plant. It's using amine scrubbing, as I described before, and it, the amount of carbon dioxide they are capturing is 1 million tons per year, what is feasible. And then you can see actually there the carbon capture plant, and you have to compress and capture. By the way, both are equally, has a very high energy penalty. Actually, both are 50% of the total energy cost and also energy and cost penalty for carbon capture that actually amounts for around two thirds of the whole CCS, because when the remaining one third is for transport storage. So anyway, as I said, this is happening already in Canada, but it's true that the main CO2 is used for enhanced oil recovery. So it's used for having some kind of economic benefit of this carbon dioxide. So they reinject the CO2 in oil gas, in oil reservoirs, to produce more oil, and they recycle, okay? So the other one is in Texas, in the United States. Again, it's chemical, it's same in scrubbing. This one is bigger. They are storaging capturing 1.4 megatons of carbon dioxide per year. And they again use that for enhanced oil recovery there in Texas. I forgot to say that in the Canada one, is an amount of carbon dioxide actually is used for pure carbon storage in what is called the aquistore project that is happening there. So it's not all for enhanced oil recovery, a small part is also used for purely CO2 storage. Okay, there are lots of many other projects of CO2 storage without the capture plan. For example, Sleipner in Norway, running from 1996, very successfully, no problem. So in terms of transport, as I said before, we have to compress. We have to compress because we have to reduce the volume of the carbon dioxide for then reduce the increase the capacity, storage capacity deep at the ground. So what we do that there is, as you see there, this is a critical point of carbon dioxide that is around 30 Celsius and in pressure is around 73 bars. So actually, normally we try to compress and transport it in this blue region, either in the liquid region or in the supercritical region where we have high densities of carbon dioxide around 700, 800 kilograms per cubic meter. Okay, so compression, as I said, has an energy penalty, together with the regeneration of the sorbent-solvent in the capture site. So about transport, well, we can transport the carbon dioxide either in pipelines or in ships or in rails or on roads. Obviously, depends basically on the many different factors, but one a key factor is the distance. If the distance is going to be around shorter of 1,500 miles, so let's kilometers, sorry, you might go actually for transport in pipelines. You might be more efficient in terms of cost. If not, you might go for ships, okay? And then we are in the geological part. Storage, as I said, you inject deep underground. Look at the deep, the depths. Those of you that are experts in oil and gas might be laughing. Those of you have no much idea about that. Just, I want to remind you that we're talking about injections of between 1-2 kilometers deep depth. So it's not just there at the ground level, right? So basically, we can actually, if we do look at one, you could inject in depleted oil and gas reservoirs, or we could use it for enhanced oil and gas recovery, as you are seeing in two, or you can inject it in saline aquifers, like Sleipner, for example, in number three, and so on. So this is basically the idea. Why you might actually wonder why it's safe to do so. So why the carbon dioxide will stay there? So there are four main trapping mechanisms. At the very beginning, when you inject that, the carbon dioxide, it will try to migrate upwards and will be trapped, what is called stratigraphic trapping, by the what is called the cap rock. So it's like normal natural gas there for millennia, for millions of years, so, or natural carbon dioxide right there. So it has been there for millions of years. This is the same. You have to be wise about where you inject that. But obviously, this is not safe, but obviously, you have to be mindful. But with time, start playing together different other trapping mechanisms. One is solubility. CO2 starts dissolving the brine that is there, the salty water is there. And although solubility is very small, the amount of CO2 you dissolve in the mass of water, brine, is small. But the question is that you have such a huge amount of brine, you end up dissolving a lot, but it takes centuries, right? Residual trapping is just because as long as the carbon dioxide is moving, the plume, as long as you are injecting, you are getting ganglias of bubbles of carbon dioxide that get trapped by porous forces, like capillary forces, and gets trapped there in the porous media you have deep at the ground. And finally, also, this starts at the very beginning, and it also takes time as long as the plume is moving. And then the mineral trapping is happening with centuries and millennia. So basically, you end up having a chemical reaction of the carbon dioxide with those brands I mentioned before, and they end up precipitating at a very stable solid phase of carbon, that is the carbonate rocks, okay? So, and as we can see it in this graph, so this is a trapping contribution, the y-axis in percentage versus the time since injection stops in from 1 to 10,000 years. And we see how also with that red arrow indicating how we increase the storage security. So at the very beginning, it's not very secure, but with time it's getting more and more safe. Why? Because we're increasing the mineral trapping that is solid. We're also increasing the solubility trapping, where actually the carbon dioxide is not in the gas or supercritical phase anymore. It's actually in the liquid phase because it's dissolved in the brine and so on. And also residual trapping that is actually getting bigger and bigger. Okay, so at the very beginning, it's all pretty much structural, just the lighter CO2 migrating upwards trapped by the cap rock, but with the time, all these other processes are playing together, residual solubility and mineral trapping, okay? So this is about science in a way, and I would like just to try to comprehend and to be concise and to summarize what are the blockers and drivers, but not only from the scientific point of view, also from economics and policies and regulations. So I'm not an expert on that, but I have the opportunity to work first at Imperial and mainly with the Scottish carbon capture and storage, maybe the largest carbon capture and storage people in the world, researchers working together in Scotland with five, six institutions working together, five, where I was honored to be one of the directorates, and I had the pleasure to work people from different disciplines, and also in Aberdeen, people from law, John Patterson, for example, or economics, Johan Finister, or of course, I forgot now, I will remember it. Alex Kemp, sorry, Alex, please help, forgive me, Alex. So anyway, blockers, let's start. Lack of coordination in policy and regulation. This is clear, a clear blocker. It was never about technology. It has been always a problem of policy and regulation. So there is no coordination between them. Not only you, I might talk about the United Kingdom, but we can talk about all the different places. This has been something hampering progression of carbon capture and storage. Cost and competitiveness, I'm trying to summarize the different ideas there so we could have actual economies of scale. They don't work if we don't have a lot of projects, big more number of projects. Contrast for difference, as it worked very well for renewables, but it was an effort to make it work in United Kingdom for carbon dioxide. What we have in the European Union, so you pay for carbon emissions, so emission trading scheme. Problem is you put the price to the carbon, and so far has been very small, very low. It's increasing now, but it still was always so low that actually wasn't very efficient. Carbon taxes, for example, I have seen happen in this state in Canada. So put the tax to carbon. Tax credits or subsidies with carbon floors, as for example is happened in some states in the United States. On enhanced capital allowance for low carbon equipment, so you are good. So there is a capital allowance for that, or maybe they are regulated asset-based financing for supporting infrastructure. It's not only the carbon, also the whole infrastructure. We need pipelines, we need injection wells, and so on. So another blocker could be the cross-chain solution. And this is quite clear to understand. So you are going to a storage. Let's say that this capture community is kind of separated from the transport or storage community. So a CO2 pipeline needs a source of carbon dioxide, so carbon dioxide has been captured. You need an industry, a power plant capturing. And in the other way around, you also need, a CO2 capture needs a pipeline available there. So, and this is also a cross-chain that requires solutions. There are silos between government departments. For example, we're all very happy and excited and enthused in United Kingdom before 2015 with this global competition, two projects going ahead. So 1 billion subsidy from the government, but it was cut, it was axed. And while there are lots of reasons, but partially it's because you didn't have a treasury support. So the deck at the time was pushing maybe, but treasury support was a support. So scale up, this is a big blocker. So just to understand it, we're not talking, remember these years I talk about global emissions. We're talking about worldwide, we are having, let's say 40, 50 gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent emissions per year. This is huge. United Kingdom is around 600 megatons equivalent per year. So this is a massive amount. So, but it has to be bigger because we want to go for net zero emissions by 2050 in United Kingdom, well in England, 2045 in Scotland, for giving you an example. So it means that we have to decrease massively the amount of carbon dioxide emissions. This means that the CCC, the carbon capture and storage capacity, together with other solutions, I mean, this is together with other solutions, also renewables, efficiency, and so on. We need to expand from 3 to 8, 35 million tons per annum after 2030. In United Kingdom now we have zero, or in Spain, basically. So in terms of carbon capture and storage, so we don't have it yet. There is, in a feasible, manageable scale. The long-term storage liability, this is an issue, is safe, and we want to be to do it very safe, but the problem is that, okay, you store the CO2 and you are telling me that it's going to be there, you will have any leakage for centuries to come. But what's going to happen in 2000 year time? Let's try go, there is a duty of care, fine. Try to find the operator, try to find the company, the government even. So what is going to have, who is going to have the liability? But it's tricky, it can be solved. And actually there are very nice and smart solutions to that. Let's say why not Brexit in United Kingdom context. So beg your pardon to my dear friends in New Zealand and Australia, but I'm using UK, could be applicable to any other parts of the world. But anyway, so uncertainties, for example, United European Union, you have a emission trade scheme. Will we apply something similar in United Kingdom? or a carbon border tax between England and Scotland with different possible models, let's say. So another blocker could be the ability to approve a huge number of applications for low carbon development in timely manner. So we have to do it, we have to act, and we have to act now. And we have to, these projects takes time, takes years actually. So the number of applications to that needs to be approved is going to, are going to be staggering, right? And finally, one that I actually, I don't take credit for this, I take credit for some very good friends, and I think is extremely important. Lack of clear narrative and leadership. This is important, extremely important. We have wasted so many years discussing about if renewables is better than carbon capture and storage and so on, and we should stop producing oil and gas, and therefore, and yes, this is fine, all these discussions are okay, but we should have a clear narrative. And we, every time you start creating a commission to think, you are wasting another year, and so on and so on. So clear narrative. So are we going to have fossil fuels in the next for a medium term? Unfortunately or fortunately, I don't take any point on that, any stake of that, but yes, it's going to be there. But we also have to reduce emissions. So let's go for carbon capture and storage. At the same time, put more renewables. Definitely, definitely. There is no question about it. Increase efficiency and so on. We need a clear narrative and action and leadership. So what about drivers? It's not negative. There are some positive things. So it's a mature technology. Not all, there are lots of carbon capture projects that are very clever, are very efficient, but still not, they are not very high up in the technical readiness levels, okay? But it's a mature technology. It has been tested and in full chain commercial ready fashion. So it's fine. There is a market for carbon capture and storage. So for example, we are talking about 100 billion pounds per year with 11 gigatons of carbon dioxide needed to be permanently stored by 2060. I'm talking about United Kingdom, eh? To meet Paris Agreement. So there is a market. And there is also an economic opportunity for storing carbon dioxide in places like, let's say, in Brazil or in Australia or United Kingdom, Norway. So we have a lot of not only a storage available, saline aquifers and oil and gas depleted reservoirs. We also have the knowledge and the people, the expertise. So we can create actually hubs that can actually both capture and also storage process, and I actually even exporting low carbon products if we produce that and storage here, okay? So there is jobs to be created. For example, there are some projections about only the Northeast, the East Coast of the United Kingdom, capturing 75 million tons of carbon dioxide per year, providing 163 billion of economic benefits and around 200,000 jobs, okay? So more drivers. Well, as I said before, we need other energy vectors. One of them is hydrogen. You could have green hydrogen, producing hydrogen from renewables. If there is an excess, a surplus of renewables, best with electrolyzers, or you could produce hydrogen, as I did explain before, by steam reforming, using departing from natural gas, or even gasification with other sources of fossil fuels, or even biomass. So here, there, you produce hydrogen, but still you have carbon dioxide and you need to capture this carbon dioxide and get rid of it. So you need CCS. So what about negative emissions? If you want to get net zero, you need some, not only reducing the emissions, you also have to have negative emissions. And there are two options, either direct air capture, that you know is trying to capture a carbon dioxide from the air. The problem is that is very dilute. We now have around 415 parts per million now, this year, of part per million of carbon dioxide concentration is very dilute. So it's very tricky to capture when it's so dilute. We like it when it's more not so dilute, which is you have higher concentration of carbon dioxide in the air mixture, in the gas mixture, sorry. But the other option is using what is called bioenergy carbon capture and storage. So basically you burn biomass that has already trapped the carbon dioxide that is the carbon that is not coming from 200 million years, what they have in fossil fuels. No, it's carbon from biomass that trap it from the atmosphere now, this year. So you are not disturbing the cycle actually. And when you burn it, you just not release the carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And you ideally will have a net zero. No, what you do is capture it and store it. So eventually what you are doing is having negative emissions. So this is there. Another option, a driver for carbon capture and storage. In mind that in the most ideal, hypothetical, utopian scenario, we produce all energy from renewables. Wonderful, or nuclear, fantastic. Still, how can we avoid CO2 emissions from the industry? The only way now, apart from some other clever ideas, but the main way is just using carbon capture and storage. Or, for example, also we could use carbon capture and storage for biofuel productions, anyway. So another energy driving is the energy integration program. So you might have an oil and gas asset, maybe for producing natural gas, but actually its power are using offshore wind and also it's producing hydrogen, and you have the same reservoir using CO2 transport and storage. So all this integration is going to be smart and clever, and it's going to reduce a lot the cost and increase a lot of efficiencies. So in terms of capacity, if I only look at United Kingdom, it's perfect because you have around 100 years of carbon dioxide storage capacity in a conservative scenario. So there is no problem. And in terms of technology, another driver is we can create actually technological and industrial clusters with associated high value jobs. As I said, we have in Australia, in United Kingdom, in Norway, we have lots of people knowing what they are doing there, about not only from the storage and transport side, also in the capture side. So we can create these kind of clusters where you, again, you are having your producer with your pipes and your pipes with your producers, with the right people to do so and create the economic benefit and jobs, and also deal with this daunting, so bleak problem we have now, that is climate change. So here we have some references I've used for this presentation. Obviously, I want to thank them all. And I think to get ready back, maybe I should actually stop sharing, maybe. So let's stop share. And then I go back to Juan. Am I right?
Yeah, that's right. Thanks very much, David. That was really interesting. So, if you've got any questions, please either write them in the chat or just feel free to unmute yourself if you can and shout up. I can kick off. So I guess from my point of view, I think probably the economic side of it is the biggest barrier at the moment. So I'm aware that the government cut the project for Peterhead that you mentioned. I just wondered what your thoughts are and what the most likely sort of positive outcome is going to be in terms of being able to fund carbon capture and storage in the UK.
Well, I think at the end is, well, you, many of you, I guess, works in oil and gas and nobody wants to be the first, am I right? So with this type of projects, there is something similar. I guess you have heard about what's going on in Norway now. Has been approved, but is going ahead, a big cluster of three industry companies capturing CO2 and going to transport and storage that in the Norwegian continental shelf. So they are going to be there the first, and obviously there is now a huge traction for a carbon capture and storage worldwide. Again, there is like a research of interest and enthused worldwide for carbon capture and storage. United Kingdom, obviously due to the pandemic, now things are completely in tatters, but not only about climate change, right? United Kingdom, look, I think we have very good examples now going ahead. The example of the project we have now with Pale Blue Dot and other companies and Total and Shell working together. So we already have something happening in St. Fergus, for example, and they have pipelines and they have a reservoir to store CO2. It's going to be a starter. We have different clusters, different regions. So in the Teesside, for example, in England, we are talking about, for example, all the Edinburgh. So all these different clusters of the big power plants producing carbon dioxide. And it's already rare, they are ready, it is happening. And in terms of economics, if really you start playing as it should be, the real carbon tax, honestly, I wouldn't go even for a carbon price. I would go for a carbon tax. So all, we have to internalize all these externalities. We are never, ever, you know, paying for the impact we are now having and the impact we will see in 10 years, 20 years, right? So we don't pay for that. So we should tax the carbon dioxide. Once we start taxing that or have a high price of carbon dioxide, or wherever, then all renewables are going to play together, nuclear all work. But the question is that without carbon capture and storage, it's going to be really very more expensive to achieve these net zero emissions. If you do it without carbon capture and storage, according with the prediction, would be 70% more expensive if you don't use carbon capture and storage. And the reason is this. The reason is that now we are using in primary energy source, 80% comes from fossil fuels. And we cannot switch suddenly. This energy transition is going to take years, obviously. So by 2030, we might be using 60%, but it still is 60%. And this is producing a lot of carbon dioxide, you see? So we are going to need carbon capture and storage. It's a yes. Especially in my opinion, we might have a debate with renewables power, yes. But for me, it's clear. We need negative emissions, and these require BECCS. We need hydrogen production, and this requires steam reforming too, maybe, probably. We are going to think that. And also, we have industrial carbon dioxide. So if we still want to see United Kingdom as being a power, and this applies to all countries, also Spain, or Australia, China, whoever you want to, you don't want to destroy the world, you are going to need, among all the other things, carbon capture and storage.
Yeah, it's interesting. So a question come in from Enrique on the chat. So thanks for excellent presentation, David. Can you please talk a little bit more about technology readiness of different CCS options? I guess post-combustion may be easier and less expensive as plants can be retrofitted, but going forward, will oxy-combustion and pre-combustion play an important role, particularly on new builds?
Yeah. Thank you, Enrique, my good Enrique. So yes, well, as I said before, the classic, the more ready available is aiming scrubbing, so the chemical absorption, that's right. Some others are really very close. For example, oxy-fuel is just almost there. So there are some bigger than pilot plants. For example, in Spain, there is one. In Zaragoza, there are other countries where actually it's ready. When we were thinking about this competition by 2015, I would like to remind you that Instituto Peterhead was a chemin, a chemisorption, but actually in the Hunter, so down in England, actually was a pre-combustion plant. So it was an integration of IGCC with pre-combustion. So it's there too, so it's almost there. There are some very clever technologies, Enrique, for example, and membranes. Membranes work well with high concentrations of carbon dioxide, let's say, and you don't reach many. So it's for niche applications. You want to push it forward, so the TRL level is still low. Other, for example, there are very clever adsorbents like MOFs, for example, using zeolites or MOFs, or there are lots of wonderful, very high temperature adsorbents working praying there that people ask, like in my community, are really very crazy about them. They work very well in the labs. So the TRL level is a 3, is a 4, a 2. Still they need support to go up. If I honest with you, the hurdle again is not in the technology, it's just investment, public money probably in some of these technologies to move it forward and to move these TRL levels higher.
Thank you, David. Gracias.
Thank you, my good Enrique. Very nice to talk to you.
Cool. Any more questions? Probably just got time for one more if anyone wants to ask anything. Nope. Okay, I guess we'll leave it there then. So
there's one coming from Shruti and Michael Dunn. I've got a couple.
Apologies.
Michael Dunn's wasn't shared to everyone. It was saying H2 production by wind power in off demand time produced gas for the grid. Are there any plants that use waste O2 to provide? I guess it means waste CO2 to provide clean oxy fuel or waste O2.
Could you, because I've seen another question in the Zoom, in the chat, could you please, Steve, repeat the question because I didn't hear it well.
That's right. It showed up as a priority. It said H2 production by wind power in off-demand time produced gas for the grid. Are there any plants that use the waste O2 to produce clean oxy-fuel? Is the way it's being phrased.
Yeah. Well, yes, it's a very good question. We are talking about, we are moving more about energy transition and net zero. Yes, you're kind of right. There is a debate about how you can produce either hydrogen or either other or more clean fuels. If we look at the hydrogen, the question is the better option would be use just electricity, right? In terms of, you say, because you avoid the capture part. The problem for that is that you need an excess of 4 times of a renewable electricity supply if you consider that you are also using electricity for producing hydrogen, for running our lives. So yes, this would be an option. You can associate, and actually there are plans moving on this direction. It's more about, it's not actually, I wouldn't consider it that like a supply of energy. I would consider it more like energy storage. So the best way to storage electricity, that is you can't, is for example, by storing that in hydrogen. And for that, you can use, for example, let's say wind energy or solar energy, when you have a valley in the demand of electricity. So I fully agree with you. So yes, there is another question I can see that about, that is related with decommissioning, actually. It's about reuse. And I'm very thankful with this question, really, because my other strand in United Kingdom, in Aberdeen, was decommissioning. I was very pleased to run the only MSc program in decommissioning for years, and I work, and I have projects, and I have lots of friends working in decommissioning now there, both in Australia and Thailand, and still in Aberdeen. Definitely, decommissioning is not about removing platforms and pipelines. No, you really go to the OSPAR and you go to the Energy Act 2006 in United Kingdom or the Petroleum Act 1998. They say reuse. Remember the triangle of the circular economy. We should start by reusing. So it's a kind of a let's say, nightmare that we are now pipelines and wells and capacity to actually reverse the flow. I'm saying that in very simple terms. Reverse the flow rather than natural gas and pumping, to the shore and to the sea, to these wells, the carbon dioxide. And for that, the investment, you have to adapt some of the pipes and wells, definitely, especially the wells, yes, there's some investment. But definitely will be much smaller than building new pipes and new wells. And also you are actually doing something useful with all this infrastructure and technology and knowledge you have there. So definitely, I fully agree with your statements, right? It's Rudy. Okay, thank you for the question. So there is another one from Chris.
From Chris, yeah.
Blockers and drivers, what can we do as individuals? As individuals in the industry to help drive this. Okay, well, this is another very good question, actually, because thank you, Chris. When we talk about individuals, we always think as users. So if I have to travel to London, I go by train and I don't go by plane. Okay, fine, wonderful. But wait a moment, many of you are working in the energy industry. Well, I would like to ask you something, and it's about the narrative. Really believe it, that is happening and it's not bad. So there are lots of opportunities there. And it must happen. For me, you have the knowledge. Nobody knows more than any one of you about this and how to do it, including the bloody academics, with all my respect, that we do our research, but it's, you know it. But you have to believe and have a clear narrative. You have to understand that this is not the end of the world for you, on the contrary, and that the oil and gas companies, if I talk about fossil fuels, they have been very reactive, but not active in the past, I mean. Eh? So, and you are the people, the ones that are moving the companies. Yeah, money is there, obviously. But at the end, the money without these people cannot play. So please have a very clear narrative in your mind. And we need you.
Nice one, David. I think that's a good point to leave it. So thank you very much once again. That was really interesting. And thank you very much, everyone, for tuning in, and keep keep in touch on your emails and social media for information about future webinars, and hopefully see you all again soon. Thanks again, David.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, everyone. And I'll be converting this into a file for YouTube as well on the SUT YouTube channel for any of you that missed some of it and want to catch up later on. And we'll ask David nicely if he's willing to let us have a copy of the PowerPoint for anyone that needs it. But,
I will do some kind of sanitizing.
Yes.
But yes, if somebody wants that in PDF form, I will do a little sanitizing.
Sure.
Maybe actually I want to tell you, maybe the drivers and blockers are the one I might actually take out, because it's a bit, I like it a lot, but it's a summary, sum up of a lot of people, and I want to take credit of something that actually is not mine, you see?
As yes. Yes.
Just for IP issues.
Excellent. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye all.